Today we'll be talking about chapter 16, section 1, and it's called Science and Urban Life. We're going to be talking about advances in science and technology and how these help solve many of the problems in big cities, including overcrowding. But first off,
America, 1900. Horses lined the main streets of every town and city in the country. Cars were still a curiosity. There were less than 150 miles paved roads in America. Trucks and buses hadn't even been invented. But the world was changing fast, and most Americans looked forward to the future, to the 20th century. The mood was confident, so was the music, especially the marches of John Philip Sousa. In 1900, Sousa and his band were invited to the World's Fair in Paris. Grand exposition to celebrate the new century. Sousa's music was becoming known around the world as the music of America. The moving picture camera was new, and these short scenes taken in Paris that summer were among the first motion pictures ever made. People were fascinated just to see things move. The Eiffel Tower, built in 1889, was the symbol of Paris by 1900. To many, it also seemed a symbol of the future, with even greater wonders ahead in the 20th century. It was the tallest man-made structure in the world, and thousands rode the elevator to the top to see the world from a new perspective.
So one of the first neat technologies we get to talk about is skyscrapers. I mean, you can see some smaller versions of skyscrapers even by going to Asheville, but you really need to go to a big city if you've never been to see those really tall ones, you know, 40 and 50 stories tall. You know, see Atlanta, see New York, go to Chicago, go to some of these huge, huge cities with millions of people. And the concern all throughout American history is how do you cram so many people into such a small space? You know, brick and mortar buildings are limited in how tall you can build them. And with more and more people crowding into cities and places becoming ever more cramped, architects learned how to build upward. Steel was the key element that made this possible. Internal steel skeletons. Also, elevators. I mean, yeah, our new building's going to be pretty sweet. You're going to be going up the stairs every day. There will be an elevator, however, for those of you who don't want to go upstairs every day. And that's only a two-story building. Yeah, that's only a two-story building. Imagine 30 flights of stairs. No one wants to go up and down that every day. It's not practical for the ordinary workforce. So elevators made skyscrapers practical. The first skyscraper was designed by an architect named Louis Sullivan, who built the Wainwright Building. Really, skyscrapers solved the problem, particularly in big cities, of limited and extremely expensive space. Because if you are going to invest that much money in downtown real estate, you want the best return on your investment. One of the coolest early skyscrapers is still around today. It's called the Flatiron Building. It's in New York. It's right on the corner of Fifth Avenue and Park Avenue, if I remember correctly. I took a selfie there. I need to put that into it. But anyway, I've only been there once. I've seen it. It's really cool. Let me show you a picture of it, though. That's the Flatiron Building. Oh, God. You've probably seen it in a lot of movies. I think it's in one of the Spider-Man movies. Yeah. But anyway, this is, if I remember, Times Square is way on down the street over this away. But yeah, this is the corner of Park Avenue, maybe, and that's Fifth. I can't remember. There's like a subway right here. Anyway, I'm not an architect, but I think one of the really neat things about this is that the designer was able to make use of this very limited space at the corner of a street and designed one of the more famous skyscrapers. But another problem that technology was able to solve, transportation. See, before the Civil War, large cities relied on horse-drawn streetcars. Some of these could travel on iron rails, and that could speed up things. Many of them, however, were simply wagons. But by 1900, and I know this sounds crazy, there were electric trolleys, electric cars in 1900. Now, they traveled along fixed lines, and I'll show you a picture of one in just a moment. But these allowed people en masse, before automobiles were even available, to travel en masse along fixed routes and to commute from outside the city in. Some cities, even as early as 1900, had elevated trains or subways going underneath the city. Because the concern is if you have a city like New York, which even at that time hosted 2 million people who all needed to get to work and all needed a place to live and all traveled back and forth every day, that's a historic amount of congestion. And all of these people want to be able to live outside the city where it's nice and quiet, but they want to be able to work in the city where the job opportunities are. And so you've got some major hurdles that technology has allowed us to overcome. Here's a photograph of a streetcar, a trolley, from 1900, an electric car in 1900. But of course, it's traveling along a fixed route, and that little antenna is connecting it to a power cable, which is above the car. Next, bridges. Most cities are built around rivers. And if we're going to be dealing with millions of people commuting on a daily basis, then we need to figure out how to get large amounts of people quickly and efficiently across rivers. And bridges have a tensile strength. If you want to go into engineering, civil engineering in particular, studies how much weight particular structures can support. And, you know, I went to an engineering school, so this is what a lot of my friends do for a living now, is build bridges. And certain types of bridges can hold certain amounts of weight. And that can be studied and that can be predicted based on the materials used in the bridges. Now, John Roebling was a civil engineer who developed the very first steel suspension bridge. And for its time, this was a game changer, because a steel suspension bridge, and I'll show you a picture of the Brooklyn Bridge, which is the first of these major undertakings, can support much more weight. That means it can be a bigger bridge. That means it can be wider. That means you can get more people across much quicker. In fact, the Brooklyn Bridge is still in operation today. The one time I got to go to New York, I drove into Manhattan via Brooklyn Bridge. Still in operation today, constructed in the late 1800s. But also, I think cities are exciting. I think you should go to several. You know, my wife and I went to Denver this summer. It was really cool. We spent an evening there, went out to a nice dinner, walked around the city for a while. They were doing some kind of big cosplay event. It was cool. Everybody in the city was dressed up in costume, and it was fun. We spent an evening there. But then by the end of the evening, we were ready to go back to a quiet place, because we're country people. It was a little stressful for us. And when I went to New York, same experience. It was beautiful. I spent most of the time looking up like giant skyscrapers. It's an amazing experience. You've got to go. But I was also happy to find Central Park. You see, Central Park is right in the middle of downtown Manhattan, one of the busiest cities on the planet. But then you go to Central Park, and you can go for a nice run or walk. You can go sit by a lake. You can go read under a tree, and you can find a quiet, peaceful place in the middle of one of the crowdiest, busiest cities on the planet. And that's purposeful. In fact, Central Park was designed by a landscape architect called Frederick Law Olmsted. And he hoped that by building Central Park, this would give New Yorkers a sense of community, because there are constant community events going on in Central Park. And it would also give New Yorkers a place to relax. Because while the city is exciting, if you live there, then you're often thinking about where can you find a quiet, peaceful place. Because cities are, even today, with our environmental controls and technology, cities do still have an odd smell to them. Cities are still very noisy, and cities are certainly very crowded, and that can be stressful and anxiety-inducing for a lot of people. And so Central Park, designed in 1857, helped correct a lot of these concerns.
The Industrial Revolution gave rise to the rapid development of cities, where great concentrations of wealth and grinding poverty lived side by side, and where open space was disappearing rapidly. To counteract the ill effects of the Industrial Revolution, a novel idea emerged in the second half of the 19th century: public parks for the enjoyment of all Americans. One prominent Bostonian believed in the transforming power of open space. Frederick Law Olmsted, the great landscape architect and conservationist. His ideas became an inspiration behind the national park system. Olmsted once wrote, "We want a ground to which people may easily go after their day's work is done, and where they may stroll for an hour, seeing, hearing, and feeling nothing of the bustle and jar of the streets, where they shall, in effect, find the city put far away from them." He believed in the great democratizing power of parks, in their ability to bring all classes together. Olmsted's firm created endless designs for parks in cities and countryside, including Rock Creek Park in Washington, D.C., and Central Park in New York City. Olmsted's greatest legacy in Boston is the Emerald Necklace, a string of city parks running 6 miles from downtown Boston to Franklin Park in Dorchester. The concept of green space was never an easy sell, but Olmsted helped convince lawmakers and others that the creation of parks was a valuable social investment. With President Teddy Roosevelt's support, Olmsted's son carried on his father's legacy, helping to pen the Organic Act that established the National Park Service. The fundamental purpose is to conserve the scenery and the natural and historic objects and the wildlife therein, and to provide for the enjoyment of the same in such manner and by such means as will leave them unimpaired for the enjoyment of future generations. Today, all of these national parks are preserved right here for all to enjoy, just as Frederick Law Olmsted would have wanted it. Their revolutionary ideas kept safe for future generations, so that you can experience your America. From the pristine seashores of Cape Cod to the Springfield Armory and John Adams' home, the National Park Service and its partners protect this Commonwealth's greatest cultural and natural legacies. And there are more than a dozen sites just within Boston to explore. Maritime adventurers, brave Minutemen, hard-working mill girls, visionary conservationists. So many have left their mark here. Most of them ordinary people with legacies far larger than themselves. That's a revolutionary idea, and perfect for Massachusetts. a land of revolutions.
So here's a photograph of Brooklyn Bridge. And this is one of the most famous and earliest steel suspension bridges. Well, of course, a steel suspension bridge relies on massive steel cables. I mean, these things are the size of a person. And these cables connect to these giant pylons. Pylons that go all the way, not only down to the bottom of the river, but deep underneath the ground. And they are the major load-bearing parts of the bridge. Well, these steel cables connect to each of the pylons, and then there's smaller cables that hold the bridge up. And that design is able to support a much greater amount of weight, meaning bigger bridge, meaning more people. That was a brilliant design, calculated using math, to be honest. Next, city planning. If you go to an old city, you know, maybe this spring or summer, you're going to go with your family to Charleston. It's a beautiful place. Charleston was built prior to a lot of city planning. It was built prior to automobiles. And that's why when you walk down the streets, you're walking on cobblestone streets. It's beautiful. It gives you a quaint feeling of what life must have been like a long time ago. But also, the streets are rather poorly conceptualized. They're not like a large city where you have long, straight avenues. No, it's more like lots of turns, narrow streets. They're not designed for lots of traffic. And so ideally, when you go to Charleston, park on the outside of the city and walk around. That's how it's designed, or that's what's intended today. But if we're going to deal with a modern concern of a growing city with millions of people, well, then we need to think about lots of traffic. And that's where city planning comes in. Daniel Burnham, another architect, drew a plan for a city with parks along Lake Michigan and also was key in designing the Great World's Fair in Chicago that I was telling you. Another exciting piece of technology. Cheap, massively produced paper. Now, Johannes Gutenberg, a German printer, changed the world forever when he developed a system of producing print quickly through movable type. But when paper became cheaper in the late 1800s through mass production techniques, more and more people could gain access to written works. And high-speed mills could produce cheap paper, and this faster production lowered the cost of paper, allowing more and more people to own more and more books. And this meant that more people could read, more people could access books, more people could read for pleasure. In fact, by 1890, the United States literacy rate reached the highest point it ever had in its history, and the highest point for any nation at that time. 90% of Americans could read and write. There are several reasons for this. You know, the growth of public schools at this time, the availability of cheap paper and books that go along with that, and also just a general improvement in the quality of life for many Americans. All right, and next, for you camera enthusiasts, photography. Before the 1880s, photography required professional equipment. You needed a stand, you needed a really clunky, very expensive device to take pictures. And so really only professionals and journalists were able to afford these cameras. However, when George Eastman introduced the Kodak camera in 1888, which was lightweight for its time. I know it's nothing like our cameras today. It was cheap relative to the cost of the professional cameras, and it was accessible to the average person. Now, I say cheap, but not really. In fact, it cost if memory serves, $80, which was a ton of money back then. And then it cost, I think, $30 to have the film developed and reloaded, because you would have to mail off the entire camera to the Kodak company. They would have to take the film out, develop it. They would mail it back, reload it with your pictures. Very expensive. So it was still considered a luxury to own a camera. However, this big innovation allowed more people to get into taking pictures. In fact, it helped create a whole field of photojournalism. From this point forward, I've got tons of pictures in a database to show you of just more stuff. We can begin looking at more pictures. Whereas when we were talking about the Civil War, I could talk about one photographer, Matthew Brady. Or moving forward, a handful of photographers like Jacob Riis, who photographed the urban poor. But there weren't many. But post-1888, there are tons of photographs because more people can start taking pictures. Next, airplanes. Of course, we all know that the first flight was in Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, but the two men who developed the first plane were bicycle mechanics who lived in Ohio. And the challenge had been for so long to develop a craft that could sustain flight. Now, gliders can fly for limited periods of time. Balloons had already solved the problem of remaining in the air. But the question and the challenge was how to sustain propulsion in the air over long periods of time. Well, the internal combustion engine was a relatively new concept. It was a form of propulsion that was light enough that could potentially, in theory, be placed on a craft supported by gliders that could sustain flight, because no other engine had been this light before. I mean, think of a steam engine. Those things weigh a ton, literally tons, and you can't put one of those on a plane. The first successful flight, tested by Orville and Wilbur Wright, was in Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, at the sand dunes. They used the sand dunes because of the high winds out there, and because if one of them crashed, they would hit a sand dune and they wouldn't die. So safety concerns, but also they needed the wind to support their craft. Of course, this wouldn't have been possible without the internal combustion engine. Now, check this out. In 1903, the first flight was demonstrated, and it was actually filmed, and we're going to watch a film of the very first flight. But within 17 years, planes were carrying the mail. Within 11 years, planes were being used in warfare, and there were even dogfights between pilots in war. So this is a game changer, obviously, but here's a little about.
For centuries, people have dreamed of flying. But until just over 100 years ago, it was thought to be impossible. One of the first people to design a flying machine was an Italian artist and inventor named Leonardo da Vinci. In about 1500 AD, he drew up plans for a complex mechanism with wings that flapped like a bird's. He felt sure his device could carry a person into the air. The problem was, humans' muscles were too weak to move such large wings, and Da Vinci's airplane never worked. But in 1783, two Frenchmen did become the first ever to fly in a human-made device. They floated over Paris for more than 5 miles, that's 8 kilometers, in a large linen and paper balloon filled with hot air. Although balloons were the first aircraft that actually carried people, they were undependable because they only went where the wind carried them. In 1899, a Frenchman named Santos Dumont made an improvement to the balloon. He set one in a rigid frame, connected a bicycle chain to propellers, and pedaled his dirigible across Paris. But it would take the invention of an engine that was light enough and powerful enough before a practical airplane could actually carry people. During the 1880s, two bicycle makers from Dayton, Ohio, believed a small gasoline engine designed for bicycles could also power an airplane. Orville and Wilbur Wright conducted many experiments, and in 1903 built a wooden glider, attached an engine to it, added two wooden propellers, and called their small craft the Flyer. On December 17th, they took it to Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, an area known for its steady winds and high sand dunes. Orville Wright climbed into the pilot seat and the Flyer was launched into the air. Their flight only lasted about 12 seconds, but the Wright brothers made history that day by proving that an engine-driven, heavier-than-air machine could fly.
So within a few years, there were concepts for biplanes. In fact, this schematic was one of the first biplanes used in combat. The Germans even figured out how to attach a machine gun on the front behind the propeller, and we'll talk more about that later, but you know, airplanes obviously changed the world. Today we'll be talking about Chapter 16, Section 2. Very short section, but we're going to briefly discuss expanding of public education, because we are involved in the process of learning, and this is at the expense of the taxpayer, and the state has graciously decided to provide us with this opportunity to receive an education. But of course, as we've learned, this is an opportunity that was not previously available to many people. And I think it's an awesome opportunity that we have. Sometimes we don't always realize opportunities that we were born into. And so hopefully as we learn about the rise of public education and how it contributed to national literacy, which is an amazing phenomenon that almost all Americans can read or write. First off, after the Civil War, many states began to pass laws requiring schools to provide services for all children, but also requiring children to attend schools. Now, previously, this only meant elementary school. In fact, really until the mid-20th century, for most people, that only meant elementary school. Kindergarten was a German concept. Around the development of children to prepare them for elementary school became very popular. But around the 1880s, here's what we have. Most children attending school were white. In fact, about 62% of children attending elementary school were white. Really only about one out of every three African American children were able to attend school. And these were segregated schools. High school, meanwhile, of course, what we're involved in, was still considered a luxury. And public high schools were still very rare. Usually they were called preparatory schools because they were designed to prepare young people for entrance into college. And they were designed primarily around academics, exclusively focused on college prep. And so you would take classes like history, math, literature. Again, classes focused on helping you acquire those academic skills. However, by 1900, while only 500,000 students nationwide were attending high schools, our industrial economy began to demand students with not only academic skills, but also technical or managerial skills. Skills that may not require a college education, but would require some type of post-elementary instruction. And high schools began to expand in what they offered to accommodate for the needs of industry. And so we began to see technical schools arise, community colleges arise, but also career and technical education opportunities within high schools. For example, the new school that we're hoping to see next year will offer you the opportunity to take classes that you don't previously have available to you. So if you're wanting to acquire skills in mechatronics, shop, construction, cosmetology, a lot of practical hands-on certification programs, those will become available to you, and those do fit a need within our community. Now, I mentioned race earlier. In high schools, even, a very small percentage of black teenagers were able to attend high school. There were some schools post-elementary for African Americans. Perhaps the most famous of these was the Tuskegee Normal and Industrial Institute in Alabama, founded by Booker T. Washington, that we're studying over the next couple of weeks. Most African American students attended private schools that had no public support. These would either be funded from within their community, or they would have to pay tuition. For example, the Tuskegee Normal and Industrial Institute was a private university funded through grants and endowments from the black community, but it was not tax supported, not for a very long time. Immigrants, meanwhile, immigrants were encouraged to attend school as part of the process of becoming Americanized, as part of the process of acquiring the English language and learning about American culture. Immigrant communities do typically hang on to aspects of their native cultures. You know, many first-generation immigrants continue to speak their native language and teach their children their native language along with the English language. It's why so many of you are dual speakers, because you have learned your native heritage and language from your families, but you've also learned the English language from attending school and just your local interactions. At this time, it was commonplace for public schools to have readings from the Protestant Bible, though Catholics attended their own Catholic schools, which would have readings from the Bible as well as readings from church teachings. Adults had opportunities to attend night school. Again, there were community colleges. There were some day programs for education for adults. But again, community college was kind of a new phenomenon at this time. University. Very few people had the opportunity to attend university at this time. In fact, maybe as few as 2% of young people had attended college. And so what we've seen as we've progressed as a society is that more people have had that opportunity. In fact, even through the early 1900s, college enrollment quadrupled. Universities have grown, and the programs they offer and the services they offer, the curricula that they can offer. Universities have also grown to become centers of research. You know, Duke University, one of the research universities in North Carolina, is still leading the fields in many different sciences. Professional law schools and medical schools have become established in the United States. And many of these universities are very exclusive, especially at this time, in terms of having entrance exams. Some would require a high school diploma, yet high schools were very rare at this time, and so many would just have very competitive entrance exams. And so you could prepare for those exams by having your family hire a private tutor, or by sending your children to these preparatory schools, which have evolved into high schools. But again, most high schools at this time were privately funded, and so the opportunity that you have just didn't exist at this time. But now a little about Booker T. Washington and W.E.B. Du Bois. The question that you are thinking about in your essay and learning about in your research is, how can racism be addressed in a society? How can we overcome racism? Booker T. Washington believed that education was one of the greatest ways to overcome racism in a society. And he realized that not enough black college graduates were getting degrees, that not enough young black Americans were getting educations. Washington believed that racism would eventually end as the black community became more educated and more equipped to enter the workforce and become leaders in their society. And he followed through on this vision by founding the Tuskegee Normal and Industrial Institute. It's now a university, primarily African American. It was founded originally as a teaching college. Normal Institute means teaching college. But it also had industrial-based curricula to teach people to be managers and leaders in their fields. It was designed to help African Americans acquire useful job skills and become leaders in their community, because Washington believed that was the best way to overcome racism. Now, W.E.B. Du Bois had a different vision, however. Now, Du Bois also believed in education very strongly. In fact, he was the very first African American to receive a doctorate degree from Harvard University, a very exclusive university with a very competitive entrance exam. Not that many people got into this university. And so Du Bois made history by being the first black person to not only attend Harvard, but receive a doctorate from there. He founded a movement called the Niagara Movement to encourage African Americans to study the liberal arts. He also believed that well-educated leaders would be needed in the black community. But where the two differed, Washington believed, essentially, that blacks should keep their heads down and should smile and accept racism as a reality, but seek to earn the approval of the white man. Du Bois strongly disagreed, though he had a respect for Washington. Du Bois believed that blacks deserved the respect of citizens, and that racism was an affront on the equality that had been promised. And Du Bois believed that blacks needed to protest and perhaps even disobey laws peacefully to challenge racism, because he believed racism was shameful and that it could be overcome by forcing whites to confront the reality of their own hatred. And so Du Bois went on to found the NAACP, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. In 1908, he founded the NAACP. So again, what you are thinking about in your essay is how to overcome racism. We all agree that's a problem. We can all understand that racism is still a problem. Washington's idea was that people should keep their head down, should not stand up for themselves, but should slowly earn the approval of a racist world. And so his goal was realized in the founding of a school. Du Bois, however, again, had this vision for overcoming racism. And really, it's become the movement that is the NAACP, that we should fight peacefully, and that we should protest, and that we should break laws peacefully to overcome racism. And so again, as you're doing your research and you're thinking about this, it is a very important question, because we all realize how troublesome racism is in our nation. And the election, sadly, has highlighted so much of this hatred. Yet, how do we overcome it? These are two fundamental ideas. Which would you choose? And that's what your essay is about. So, today we'll be talking about Chapter 16, Section 3. And the title of this one is Segregation and Discrimination. Yesterday we talked about Booker T. Washington and W.E.B. Du Bois, two leaders in the civil rights movement of that time. But next we need to look at the situation of that time. We talked about how racism in the 1800s and early 1900s was very overt, very direct, very apparent in society. And we talked about two strategies to combat that racism, but we had to confront the reality that racism still exists in our country and has become more outspoken and overt, perhaps in this election, than it has been in years. And it is scary when we think about how far this can go, when we look at how far it has gone in the past. For example, in regards to voting, for at least a decade after Reconstruction, Southern blacks were able to vote. And as we learned, the voting rate among Southern blacks was the highest at that time that it has ever been. In some states, 90% of African Americans were voting. By 1900, however, all Southern states had restricted the vote, denying blacks the right to vote. But wait, Southern states were restricting the right to vote to blacks? I thought the 15th Amendment gave blacks the right to vote. How were Southern states restricting the vote? They found a loophole, you see. Because when a people don't want to obey a law, they're going to find a way around it. You're going to find your way to send that text message if you absolutely have to. You're going to find a way to oppress people if that's your desire to do so. And that's what Southern states found, was a loophole. They could limit the vote to those who could read through a literacy test. Some states also required a poll tax, meaning that in order to vote, you would have to pass a test proving you could read or write, but then you would also have to pay a tax. Now check this out. All of these Southern states, North Carolina included, that used these literacy taxes and poll taxes did not require their white citizens to jump through those hoops. You see, white citizens were able to vote prior to 1867. Well, guess what happened in 1867? That's when the 15th Amendment was passed. And so Southern states passed these laws specifically directed at preventing blacks from voting. And so the grandfather clause allowed white voters to participate in the election if their father, themselves, or their grandfather had been able to vote prior to 1867. Bottom line, if your skin was all right, you was all right. Or if your skin was white, you was all right, as the old song went. And while states were not able to put up signs saying, if you was black, you better turn back, and this is from a song you'll hear on one of the clips that I'll play. But that's what they did, in fact, is they were barring blacks from voting in these states, North Carolina included. And that's very unfortunate. Again, sometimes it's tough to understand how does racism affect us as a society. And sometimes we have to understand what can it come to. You see, we have enjoyed the privileges of a democracy since 1776, or have we? What does democracy mean? That means a nation led of the people, by the people, and for the people. But that's not true. Not if the people mean white male property owners. Not if the people simply mean white people. Because in the South, blacks were being disenfranchised, meaning they weren't actually a part of a democracy. They were part of a government they didn't get to choose. That's called a tyranny. And so tyranny reigned in southern states until 1965. And there are many among us who would like to make it that way once more. And the unfortunate reality is that former slaves who had once been considered property under the law, who were now able to participate in a free and democratic society, like this charcoal engraving dating back from the 1800s of this former slave going up to vote, were now being denied. The Supreme Court, meanwhile, turned a blind eye to this. In the 1870s and the 1880s, the Supreme Court ruled that the poll tax and the grandfather clause and the literacy tests were not violations of the 15th Amendment, according to their interpretation. Meanwhile, segregation was the law of the land. This was called Jim Crow, from an old song that contained the words, "Jump, Jim Crow, jump," which indicated that blacks had better do as they told. It was mostly in the South, though, of course, discrimination existed nationwide. But this discrimination, this segregation, was mandated, was the law of the land. It was not always written down, but in some cases it was. There were hundreds of brown towns in North Carolina. These were towns where it said, and you can look them up if you don't believe me, and there were towns around here within an hour's drive, half hour's drive in some cases, where you would see signs and it would say, "Don't let the sun go down on your black ass." And those towns were within a half hour of this place. And those signs were up in some cases until the 1990s. And that's sad. And that's hateful. But that is a reality that we have to confront as a community, and that we live among people who still feel that way. Again, as I said, the racism perhaps in the 1890s was more direct, but it hasn't gone away. In 1896, the Supreme Court ruled in Plessy v. Ferguson that separate but equal would be the law of the land, and that segregation was not a violation of the 14th Amendment. The condition was that equal facilities would have to be provided. But as we've seen in photographs and videos and documentation, and perhaps your parents or grandparents could give you more context, separate but equal was a farce. Blacks could not go to white hospitals. In some cases, blacks could not even be buried in white cemeteries. Blacks could not use white restrooms. They could not go to white schools. In some cases, these schools didn't even have textbooks for their children. Didn't even have heat. And what Brown v. Board was able to prove much later was that separate but equal is not true. Because in reality, this is what Southerners were trying to do. And the Klan was all too willing to be the arm of this. If Southern men tried to show up to vote, they'd be denied. Perhaps they had the money to pay the poll tax. Perhaps they could pass the literacy test. There was a case of a man who passed the literacy test, who paid his poll tax, and then he was given a test in Greek. Well, guess what? He was a professor. He read Greek. They then produced a test in Mandarin Chinese. And with tears in his eyes, this man said, "This means I don't get to vote." And in some cases, the Klan would show up. They'd be standing outside election offices, watching who was going in to vote, marking who they were. Even still to this day, when I walked in to vote last week, I was looking around me. I was suspicious of who was watching me vote. I wanted to make sure there were no one sketchy outside. Because if it's happened once, it can happen again.
In 1895, black people in Louisiana decided to test the constitutionality of the new laws. One segregation law required separate railroad cars for Negro passengers. Homer Plessy sat down in a car reserved for whites and was arrested. Because of the 14th Amendment and its equal protection clause, Plessy never imagined the Supreme Court would rule against him, but it did. The court upheld his conviction in a decision which would shape race relations for half a century. In Plessy versus Ferguson, it ruled. The 14th Amendment could not have been intended to abolish distinctions based upon color or a commingling of the races.
And the tragedy of Plessy is that having then held that you could discriminate on trains, the doctrine then was applied to a whole host of other areas, to all public accommodations, to boxing matches, to education, and in some instances, in the early years, in housing. And it gave the imprimatur that the law in America could do to blacks what it couldn't do to Irishmen, or Italians, or Jews.
The Plessy decision introduced a new phrase into the language, separate but equal. 21 states would soon pass segregation laws under the protection of Plessy. The turn of the century saw the existence of two Americas, one white and one colored. Colored America could not eat in white restaurants, play in white parks, die in white hospitals, or be buried in white cemeteries. Oklahoma even segregated phone booths. Mississippi segregated Coke machines. In Atlanta, a Negro witness could not swear on white Bibles. Florida segregated not only the schools, but even the textbooks in storage.
If you want to ride the bus, then you put your nickel in the slot and you go into the back of that bus and you sit down and shut up. And if you came in that bus as a white person and you wanted my seat, then I got up and gave you my seat. We were not supposed to mix the races. That was the law of the land. So you had to abide by that law, or otherwise you went to jail. It was just that simple.
This was the era of Jim Crow.
This little song that I'm singing about, people you all know is true. If you black and got a word for a living now, this is what they will say to you. They say, if you's white, she's all right. If you's brown, stick around. But if you's black, oh, brother, get back, get back, get back.
The promise of the 14th Amendment, the promise of equality before the law, had been derailed. And in practice, many black people had been removed from the protection of the law altogether. The Jim Crow era was a time of unprecedented racial violence. Over 2,000 African Americans were lynched in the first years of this century.
Southern trees bear strange fruit, blood on the leaves and blood at the root, black bodies swinging in the southern breeze, strange from the poplar trees.
This was the divided America in which Charles Hamilton Houston grew up. He was born in 1895 in Washington, D.C., 1 year before the Plessy decision.
You see, racial etiquette were often unwritten rules and customs that dictated black and white relations. Blacks were to get out of the way if a white person was approaching on the road. Blacks were not to make eye contact, were to act in a subservient manner, were to say, "Yes, sir," "Yes, ma'am," to speak when spoken to in regards to relations with whites. If they acted in a way that a white person interpreted as uppity, they could be beaten or killed. This was all meant to enforce a second-class citizenship status for blacks. Mainly this was in the South, but we also saw this in the North. Reformers like Booker T. Washington were popular among whites because as you're doing your web quest, you're going to learn where he was telling blacks to keep their heads down, to be patient, to wait a lifetime if necessary, but someday the white man will respect us. But here we are, a lifetime later, and we're still seeing such hate and such anger. It makes me very sad. But again, Booker T. Washington had his hope that someday blacks would earn the respect of whites by growing their communities, accepting discrimination, accepting segregation, and going along with the flow. W.E.B. Du Bois, however, as well as Ida B. Wells, Sojourner Truth, many others, spent their lives fighting for racial justice in peaceful ways. Ida B. Wells was born a slave, amazing lady. You know, if you're wanting a strong woman to study for your topical, Ida B. Wells is a great one. She spent her life and career trying to put an end to lynching. She would put up those flags, a man was lynched yesterday everywhere. In fact, that flag, that photograph, was flying from the office of the NAACP in New York. Because sadly, I'm not just talking about separate schools. I'm not just talking about back of the bus. We're really talking about horrible acts of violence and terrorism that were sanctioned by large majorities of our southern communities. In fact, in this one decade alone, between 1882 and 1892, more than 400 African Americans were killed. And yes, there was discrimination in the North as well. You know, I don't just teach this lesson to make you all feel guilty for what we've come through. But we as a nation have to realize this. This is part of who we are and who we were, and hopefully who we will never be again. But as the old saying goes, and I hope you'll all go to D.C. with us next year, and you'll walk around the Holocaust Museum, and it's tragic. I mean, you're going to want to take some time to collect yourself before you go back to the group. And they have a room just for that, in fact. It's called the Silent Room. There's a little flame. You go there, you kind of take some time, and then you go back and laugh and enjoy your trip. Well, there's a quote on the wall as you're walking into that room, and it says, "When they came for the Jews, I said nothing because I was not a Jew. When they came for the gypsies, I said nothing because I was not a gypsy. But then they came for me." Because you see, if we condone, if we are silent in a society where people act this way, then we vote by our silence. And yes, as many blacks were getting the heck out of the South, and I don't blame them, many were also finding the same discrimination in the North and being forced into segregated neighborhoods. In many cases, the poor would reject African Americans because there was a movement among the wealthy to convince the poor that blacks were a scapegoat, that immigrants were to be blamed for their problems, that their problems were caused by minorities. And it made them blind to the real problem. And so, yes, there was competition between blacks and working class whites. But discrimination was not limited to African Americans, nor is it today. And so let's have that conversation about Hispanic Americans. Obviously, through the present day, starting in the mid-1800s, many Latinos have been moving to the United States for the same reasons that our ancestors moved here, for the same reasons that your parents maybe even came here, for opportunities, for a better life for themselves and their children. Many Mexican Americans moved here to the Southwest in the 1800s. A big draw and employer were the railroads. But yet, Hispanics were forced to work for less than other groups. And commonly throughout our history, that has been the situation. In fact, many Hispanics were the dominant labor force in Southwestern agricultural industries. Still today, if you go to farms, even in the Southeast, the primary labor force are Latinos. And there was a system of slavery. It has now been outlawed and declared unconstitutional in 1911, but there was a system of slavery that existed for Latinos called that peonage, that existed and was sanctioned and was allowed up until 1911. And yet still today we have a situation where many Hispanic Americans are forced into a second-class citizenship status and are forced to work for less than what others are making and are still being treated as inferior and still being blamed for the problems that we have. And yet, haven't we seen this with the Irish? Haven't we seen this with other immigrant groups? Now we're seeing this with African Americans. And it's sad. It does. It makes me angry. Not at you. Never at you. But it just makes me sad. But you see, what we have to understand is this problem is systemic. I don't know how to change it. All I can do is raise awareness of it. Some of it comes from resentment. The fact that immigrants like the Chinese were coming here and seeking a better life just like everyone else, but were being forced into jobs that paid them less because that's all they could find that was available. And as other people were facing job competition from a swelling labor market, instead of blaming the proper channels, they would blame their fellow workers as the cause of their problem. Them immigrants taking our jobs, I've heard that. I'm sure you've heard that. And that's unfortunate. I showed you a quote at the beginning of this course from Ben Franklin where he said, them Germans, those swarms of Germans coming in, those are my ancestors. But it's always been the case when people come in to a new place and they have to take what they can get, and then they become the scapegoat for others' problems. I'll show you in a minute. Today we'll be looking at chapter 16, section 4, and it's called The Dawn of Mass Culture. And I love these types of lessons. We get to talk about pop culture, what did people do for fun, and as Americans had more time for leisure activities, as more Americans could read and write, more demand for newspapers, we can begin to talk about American culture, not just South versus North, not just what did people do in these particular pockets of rural areas that never got out and saw one another. We can begin to talk about common shared experiences that all Americans can relate to. And I think that's exciting. In a way, that was Henry Clay's dream, that we would all come together. And perhaps it was never politics that brought that to a reality. Maybe it was technology. Maybe it was the fact that more people could read, more people could participate. And so what did Americans do? What does it mean to be an American in regards to fun? So we talked about city parks, Central Park being the most famous. And so as cities were setting aside green space, such as parks, for recreation, many cities were also building amusement parks. They would often be built on the outskirts of cities. Of course, you've hopefully been to several, maybe Carowinds, maybe Dollywood. Six Flags was a big favorite for me as a kid. And these amusement parks would feature rides. In fact, the very first roller coaster in our country was in New York, in Coney Island. The very first Ferris wheel ever built was in Chicago for the Great World's Fair. And while these Ferris wheels and roller coasters were made of wooden frames, and so they were limited in what they can do. I mean, we're not hanging by our shoulders doing loops on the Superman ride yet, but we'll get there, right? And the neat thing that we can talk about in this section is what people did for fun. For example, bicycling. Early bicycles were not terribly practical. In fact, they were rather dangerous. The wheels would be made of wood often, and the wheels in some cases were built in a very impractical way, some as tall as a person's head. And you would need a stepladder to climb up onto the front wheel, which was very, very tall with a very short rear wheel. I never got that design. But anyway, bicycles allowed a mobility that people had not previously been able to access before, particularly for women. Women were able to move around more and access things outside the home that they had not been able to do. The safety bicycle was a game changer. The safety bicycle looked more like the modern bicycle, front and rear wheels of similar height, but most importantly, rubber wheels. That vulcanized rubber of Goodyear tires made that possible. Tennis was also a popular pastime. It was originally a British sport, and it's become very popular in the United States. Your book has this really weird picture of a multi-bicycle. I don't know why they decided to feature that, but again, you know.
It's because they're dressed like a rainbow.
Yeah, I mean,
I don't get it.
I guess, you know, the pop culture lessons aren't meant to be terribly serious. But anyway, some people just decided to take it to the next level. Okay. Yep. Spectator sports. You know, I love bicycling. I mean, I ride my bike, you know, probably 5 days a week. But it's not for everybody. You know, I like tennis. I enjoy it. But again, it's not for everybody. Some people prefer to watch sports. You know, of course, baseball is one of the oldest American pastimes, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. But even older than baseball is boxing. Now, boxing has been around for, well, I mean, since people decided that you could shape your hand into a fist. But the sport of boxing is also an ancient contest. And it's been popular throughout American history. One of the earliest boxing legends was John Sullivan. And with the advent of the radio, many Americans would tune in to listen to boxing matches. Boxing, as well as baseball, became very profitable businesses. Because if the standard of living is going up, which it was at that time, that means more Americans have more money. Now, also, as workers' lives were getting better, you know, the 8-hour workday was something that people were slowly winning the right to. As technology was increasing, we'll talk about that later, we have many labor-saving devices. Bottom line, people are experiencing more leisure time and more flexible income. And what are they going to do with that? Well, they're going to be able to have fun. And they're going to be able to, well, in the 30s, go to the movies. In the early 1900s, listen to the radio. In, you know, the late 1800s, even going to sporting matches, reading the newspaper. But of course, we have to talk about baseball. The first baseball club was organized in 1845 by a man named Alexander Cartwright. Set down the very first rules for baseball. Now, from 1845 forward, the sport has evolved greatly. The first leagues formed by 1876. There was the National League, and then a few years later, the American League formed. And these two leagues still compete for the right to send a team to the World Series. And so if you followed the World Series recently, you know, the Cubs won the pennant in their league, and the Indians won the pennant in their league, and then the two faced off in the World Series, of course. Baseball has been a spectator sport in American history for a very long time, as you can see. And it has also been an avenue for the civil rights movement. There are many famous African-American baseball players, Jackie Robinson being one of the more famous, but that comes later. And these athletes had to encounter discrimination. And they had to handle it in a public way because they were public figures. For example, African-Americans at this time were not allowed to play with white Americans. And so they formed their own league because baseball was an American phenomenon. And in many ways, sports did bring us together because it was a dominant form of spectator entertainment. Okay, so again, as I was saying, baseball became a public forum highlighting the issue of discrimination. And it would be many, you know, brave black baseball players who would advance the cause. But on to newspapers. More Americans were reading than ever before, 90% roughly by 1900, and that increased demand for newspapers. With cheaper paper, newspapers became more affordable. With increased standard of living, most Americans could afford to buy the newspaper. And of course, prior to social media, this is how Americans got their news at this time. And so newspapers were a big business. It's almost sad to say they were. They still are. But, you know, the digital age is changing journalism dramatically. You know, where I still grew up reading the paper, you guys probably didn't. But as far as newspapers, just like media today, have to attract viewers. They are a business that requires your attention to make money. And so unless they draw you in, they don't make money. So think of clickbait. You all know what that is, right?
No.
Okay. Really?
Oh, yeah, now I know what it is.
Okay, come on. I can't be the only one obsessed with social media. So clickbait is a form of journalism today that uses sensational headlines to draw you in. If you click on the link, that increases their ad revenue. All you have to do is click. And so they have to draw you in with something. You know, think of the tabloids, you know, Bat Baby Rescued by Jesus. Oh, okay, I'm sitting in line. Bat Baby Rescued Jesus? Huh? Okay, then I've picked it up. And maybe I'm like, hey, that's kind of crazy. I'm going to buy it. Well, you know, print journalism is on the way out. Digital journalism, again, still requires your attention, still requires you to click on that link. Traffic, that's what media relies on. It relies on your attention. And so think before the digital age, what does a newspaper need to get you to buy it? You know, to get you not only to pick it up and read the headline, but then to be interested enough to read what's under the headline. Because to read what's under it, well, you're going to need to buy the newspaper. So, two of the most famous newspaper publishers at this time are Joseph Pulitzer of the Pulitzer Prize and William Randolph Hearst, who famously started, allegedly, the Spanish-American War to sell newspapers. They hyped it up, they hyped it up, they hyped it up. They would notoriously exaggerate the news. It's a good thing that never happens anymore, right? Wink, wink. They would notoriously over-dramatize small events. Why? Because it gets us talking, it gets us watching, and it gets us reading.
Just why nobody likes politics.
Yeah, I mean, I'm so over the election. I hate to say it, I just am. Because we are so inundated with, yeah, and I mean the election, and then I can't say it's going to be over, but we are so inundated with the media trying to sell us on the election. And so in many ways, the type of media that exaggerates the news, well, we see that every day. Moving on. The arts. Photography provided journalists and artists a chance to portray realism in a way that had never been possible before. Now, of course, photography had been around for some time, but the Kodak camera and the Kodak company offered an opportunity for the average American to engage in realism. So, in the arts as well, realism was becoming very popular. Artists like Thomas Eakins were famous for portraying life as it was. In fact, there was an entire school of art called the Ashkin School devoted to realism. Many of their artists would paint portrayals of life in the city as it really was. I've shown you some examples of that. Portray examples of working people. Abstract art was also introduced and becoming popular at this time. And just like today, many people find abstract art difficult to understand, but many do enjoy it as a form of expression.
Maybe we could say it was a funny drug reaction to the flu.
Who's got the story?
Hey, don't you want to know if it's true?
What difference does it make if it's true? It's a story and it breaks, they're going to have to run with it. How long we got till it breaks?
Front page, Washington Post tomorrow.
Oh, well, yeah, no, that's not good. Okay. Just got to distract him. Got to listen 2 weeks till the election.
What in the world would do that? What in the world would do that?
Well, I'm working on it. The Gulf War, smart bomb falling down a chimney, 2,500 missions a day, 100 days. One video of one bomb, Mr. Moss. The American people bought that war.
Mm-hmm.
War is show business.
You want me to produce your war? Not a war, it's a pageant. We need a theme, a song, some visuals. We need, you know, it's a pageant.
It's a pageant.
It's a pageant, that's what it is.
Country's a war.
It's Miss America and your bird parks.
Why Albania?
Because.
Well, they have to have something we want.
Well, I'm sure they
do. What do we have that they want?
A little freedom.
Well, why would they want that?
Oppressed?
No. Fuck freedom. They wanna destroy the godless Satan of the United. They want to destroy our way of life, all right?
Albanian terrorists have placed a suitcase bomb in Canada in an attempt to infiltrate the bomb into the USA.
Oh, that's good.
The president's going to go to war with Albania in about 30 minutes.
You're declaring war in Albania?
No, we're not declaring war. We're going to war. We haven't declared war since the Second World War.
Going to war.
The president of the United States has said that he apologizes for the need for secrecy, and he assures that it is necessary for the safety of the men and women in combat. He says that the Republic of Albania, long a staging ground for terrorism around the world, He is mentioning that a state of war is or is about to happen between the United States and the Republic of Albania.
Do you know who we are?
I'm afraid that's the trouble, Miss Ames.
CIA. Yeah, CIA.
Two things I know to be true. There's no difference between good flan and bad flan. And there is no war. We show, and NSA confirms, there are no nuclear devices on the Canadian border. There are no nuclear devices in Albania. Albania has no nuclear capacity. Our spy satellites show no secret terrorist training camps in the Albanian hinterland. The Border Patrol, the FBI, the RCMP report no, repeat, no untoward activity along our picturesque Canadian border. The Albanian government is screaming its defense. The world is listening. There is no war.
Of course there's a war. I'm watching it on television.
The spy satellites show it, Mr. Breen. They show no war.
Then what good are they if they show no war? I mean, what are we spending $250 billion a year on the Defense Department? What good are they if they show nothing? And what, are they useless? Are they just broke or what? I mean, what is it? If there's no threat, then where are you? Let me go you one more. If there's no threat, what good are you?
Mr. Breen, you are the threat.
I'm the threat. I am the threat. Well, what have I been doing the last 30 years that you haven't been doing? You want to fill me in on that?
The last 30 years, Mr. Breen, I have been working to ensure the security of my country.
As have we all. And I would like to point out that the security of this country...
But if forced to choose between the security of your country and the security of your job, which would you pick?
It's not...
And while you hesitate, permit me to suggest that they are one and the same, your country and your job.
I'm doing my job, Mr. Breen. That's what you see me doing.
I'm doing my job.
What is it you are doing?
I'm doing my job, too. And let me ask you something. Let me ask you a simple question. Why do people go to war? Why do they go to war?
I'll play your silly game.
Okay, why do they go to war?
To ensure their way of life.
Would you go to war to do that?
I have.
And if you went to war again, who would it be against? Huh? Your ability to fight a two-ocean war against who? Who? Sweden and Togo? That time has passed. It's over. The war of the future is nuclear terrorism. It is, and it'll be against a small group of dissidents who, unbeknownst perhaps to their own governments, have blah, 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 blah. And to go to that war, you have to be prepared. You got to be alert. The public has got to be alert, because that is the war of the future. And if you're not gearing up to fight that war, then eventually the axe will fall, and you're going to be out in the street. And you could call this a drill. You could call this job security. You could call it anything you like. But I got one for you. You said go to war to preserve your way of life. Well, Chuck, this is your way of life. And if your spy satellites don't see nothing, if there ain't no war, then you can go home and prematurely take up golf, my friend. Because there ain't no war but ours.
Thank you. Thank you.
Drive carefully.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Nice enough people, they just haven't thought it through.
But as I said, the media, newspapers, journalists have often had the reputation of exaggerating the news. In fact, when we get to the Spanish-American War, I'm going to tell you about how William Randolph Hearst of the New York Herald sent a journalist to report on the condition of the Cuban Revolution. And he telegraphed back to his boss, and he said, there's really nothing going on in Cuba. It's not that exciting. Spain's got it under control. You know, it's just not really. And Hearst telegraphed back quickly, and he said, you furnish the pictures. Just take your pictures and shut up. I'll take care of the war. He said, send me some pictures, and I'll come up with headlines to get Americans riled up and start a war. And in fact, many could argue, and this is just one of the clear examples of where the media has really... taken over. And so the new journalism here portrayed by this cartoonist is taking taking us off the break, if you will. But next, pop fiction. You know, before television, people read serial publications. You know, my wife and I, we do love some TV. You know, we watch some Netflix and some Hulu, and even from time to time when we can get HBO. But we like serials, meaning an ongoing story. You know, we're currently watching Homeland. It's about a guy who may or may not be a terrorist. Great show. Anyway, don't spoil it for me. I'm just pointing it out, saying it's a neat story. I'm four episodes in. I still don't know if dude's a terrorist. And I think that's a really cool way to tell a story. Well, serial fiction in the written form is also very popular. Of course, comic books are one portrayal of this. Pulp fiction. The term pulp fiction refers from the pulpwood of cheap paper that can be churned out in very, very cheap novels. And one of the most famous pulp fiction writers was Mark Twain. Samuel Langhorne Clemens, the comedian, who used the pseudonym Mark Twain to write some of the most famous American novels. Of course, Tom Sawyer and Huck Finn, but also, I mean, he's written a ton of them, and he's really funny. But he also points out a lot of, you know, big problems in American life, like any good comedian would, right? You know, think of Louis C.K., think of The Daily Show. You know, those are both forms of political satire. While they're really funny and entertaining, even if that's not your thing, think of SNL. All of those three publications or comedians are forms of satire. And they all poke fun at the real world. And that's exactly what Mark Twain did in his time. And instead of high culture, you know, I'm sure you've read your share of literature, or you've taken classes on literature, or maybe you've read the Odyssey, maybe you've read some Shakespeare. You'll notice when you read Mark Twain, it's a lot simpler to read. You know, one day, one summer, I decided, I was like, okay, I'm going to be a history teacher. I need to struggle through and read the Iliad. And by gosh, I read the Iliad, and it felt like a summer reading assignment, and I was having to, like, hold the eyelids open as I was reading this book. And it was good for me, I guess, but it was one of those books I had to make myself read. But then when I was your age, I picked up Connecticut Yankee and King Arthur's Court. And it was funny. It was silly. It was entertaining. Because it's about a guy from the future going back to the castle times, and guess what he does? He builds a machine gun and kills everybody. And it's just great. And he's really funny about it.
That's awesome.
You know, and you have these, like, ridiculous scenes. And he's complaining about politics because, of course, they have some silly elections back then, too. And he said, hey, we should just elect cats and have this cat run versus this cat, etc. And then we can all just obsess about cats instead of presidents because they're kind of worthless anyway. And that was Mark Twain. Well, anyway, he just decided to make a career of it. And he was very famous in doing so. Of course, read Huck Finn. That's a great starter. Many were dime novels. Louis L'Amour, probably one of the more famous dime novelists of the West. But anyway, you got to read Huck Finn. It's just required reading to grow up in the United States. It's also just a really cool story about a kid who decides to take a boat, actually build a boat, and take it all the way down the Mississippi.
Slumming, I am. But of course, you'd rather work.
What do you call work?
Well, ain't that work?
Well, all I know is it suits Tom Sawyer.
Say, let me whitewash a little.
Think I'd let a dude whitewash?
Oh, come on now. I'd let you if you was me.
No. If it were the inside, I wouldn't mind. And Aunt Polly wouldn't. But she's awful particular about the outside.
Oh, shucks. I'd be careful. I'll give you the rest of my apple.
Well, here. No, I'm afeard.
And I'll give you this, too.
Ain't that a humdinger? What is it?
It's a knob off a brass door knocker.
All my life I wanted a knob off a brass door knocker. Well, here. Quick, before I change my mind.
Shh. shopping. Obviously, the way we have shopped has changed, but it can still be fun to go out to town and go to the mall. It can still be fun to go to a big shopping center. Well, if you're into shopping and going to the mall or having that shopping experience is something fun for you, the very first shopping center opened in 1890. It featured a glass top arcade with a piano player, so live entertainment as you shopped. And so this was meant to be a retail shopping experience. High-end luxury products catering to people willing to spend some hard cash. But then also, department stores became popular at this time as well, offering large quantities of reasonably priced goods. The very first department store opened in 1865, and this opened in Chicago. Now, the department store versus the retail store focuses on bargains. The idea of the bargain basement, that you can't beat our prices no matter what. We will batch or beat any competitor. That's a department store concept versus a retail outlet. You know, if you go to Mass General Store on Main Street, you're not necessarily searching for the cheapest product. You're searching for some really cool stuff, maybe some nice clothes. You know, I'm always trying to find a hat that works for me. I just can't. I don't know why. I'm like hat disabled or something. But, you know, when I go to Mass General Store, I'm always like trying. I'm like, huh, yeah, okay. You know, and because they have a lot of nice products there. But now when I go to Walmart, I'm on a mission. I'm like, I need a bunch of stuff really cheap, and I want out of here. There's the department store for you versus Mass General Store, which is meant to provide you more of an experience. Anyway, and maybe I even got ahead of myself. Mass General Store is a great example of a retail store, whereas department store has mainly today been replaced by the chain store, because most department stores you'll go into are chains. You know, like Walmart, where you can go to any Walmart in the country and see the same basic format. That concept was developed by a man named F.W. Woolworth. And Woolworths still exist today. There are some, not many left. But this man realized that he could offer, and we're all guilty of this, folks, poor quality products at reduced prices, and people would buy them because it's a bargain. And we are all guilty of this. You know we are. Yeah, we have all bought something that we know is not that great because it's dirt cheap. You know, and I've just had to make myself learn over time it's better to have fewer nice things than lots of junk. But we're all still attracted by a big sale. Yeah. Now, Woolworth set up his chain store in a really neat way. Number one, he set up several of these stores as he became more successful, and he would set them up in the exact same way in every single store. So when you walk into a Woolworth's anywhere, you automatically know where stuff is. But he also designed the aisles in a way that you would have to walk through every aisle to get to the register. Clever, right? Now, the old way of shopping, and if you watch any old movies, you can sometimes find this, is you would go up to the front counter and you would tell the clerk or hand them your shopping list, and they would go find everything for you. And you can still do that today. In fact, my wife went to pick up some things over the weekend. She did an online order on Walmart, and they had everything ready for her at the store, at the counter. And they do offer that service as a convenience. However, it is in these chain stores' best interest for you to just aimlessly wander around the aisles. And so they set them up that way. They also purposely limited service, limited personal service. And this was partly to save the money because they had to hire fewer people, but it was also to give you that experience of just wandering around and looking at stuff and realizing that you needed all of the stuff that you didn't actually need before. And then finally, advertising. Advertising exploded in the late 1800s and early 1900s. Just look alone by the budget, the amount spent per year on advertising, which really pales in comparison to today's world. But people began to see advertisements on billboards, in newspapers, sides of buildings. You know, some of the famous advertisements from these days included barns. In East Tennessee, where I'm from, Sea Rock City was a common big sign put all over barns. All right. Not all shopping was done in the store. Some of it could be done from home. The very first mail order catalogs called the Sears and Roebuck could be delivered to small towns all across the country. And so if you were this guy, you're not going to Woolworth, sorry. How are you going to get stuff if you're this guy in Kansas? Anybody? I mean, you could make your... Exactly. Okay, you're going to order stuff, right? And, prior to Amazon, you're going to order it from a catalog. And now I'm dating myself a bit, but I do remember ordering things from a catalog. Often you would have to wait 6-8 weeks was the usual standard, because it would have to be, your order would have to be mailed off and return to you. But it gave people access to the quantity of goods that you might expect from a department store, but from the convenience of your home. All right, so that's all I've got. So we're going to transition into group time, and then I believe we've got some presentations coming up. So if our first group would like to come up and start getting yourself ready. Meanwhile, continue working on your new group stuff.